In this video, we're going to learn the anatomy and physiology of the ear. Not only the external ear that you see on the side of your head, but all the internal structures as well. The whole process of taking sound waves in the air around us and converting those into electrochemical signals that our brain can interpret the meaning of. You'll learn everything in this diagram, as well as the internal workings of the cochlea. And at the end, you'll have a blank diagram that you can use to practice to make sure you know this stuff really, really well. So lend me your ears and your brain. Let's jump to the whiteboard and get started. So let's start with an outline of the ear, including the outer part that you maybe think of when you hear ear, as well as the internal structures right here. Let's label some parts of this to kind of orient ourselves. First, we have some bone that we're gonna draw in here. That's part of the skull. We've got a layer of fat. We've got some cartilage, like a lot of your outer part of your ear is made of pieces of cartilage. And then we've got a muscle that I drew in right here. That's the temporalis muscle that's used to like lift up your jaw whenever you're chewing. And our first actual structure that we're gonna name here is called the auricle, also known as the pinna. The only function of it is to funnel sound waves down through the rest of the parts of the ear. If you think about it, it's kind of shaped like a funnel. It faces a little bit more forward and kind of to the sides. And so our ears are set up best for hearing things in front of us or from the sides. Less good at things behind us, but if we hear a startling noise, think about it, you immediately are gonna turn to face wherever that noise is. So our ears are set up to take sound in kind of our field of vision and funnel it into our heads, into the inner structures of the ear. So the auricle is gonna funnel sound vibrations into our auditory canal, which is also known as the external acoustic meatus. And this is gonna be a tube that runs through the skull into the inner parts of the ear. So that's the auditory canal. It's the part if you take your finger and stick it in your ear, you're sticking your finger into this section right there. If you were to take a Q-tip and stick into your ear, you could get it further down, but don't do that because if you stick that Q-tip too far into the ear, you're gonna come into contact with the tympanic membrane or the eardrum. Touching the eardrum can really damage it, so Q-tips are a big no-no. So the auricle is gonna funnel sound through the auditory canal, and those sound waves are gonna bounce up against the tympanic membrane. The tympanic membrane's job is to vibrate every time those sound waves hit it. So every sound that you hear from this video is causing your tympanic membrane to vibrate like this. It's kind of these in and out vibrations like that. Now the tympanic membrane or eardrum is the dividing line between the parts of the ear that we call the outer ear and the parts of the ear that we call the middle ear. There's also gonna be an inner ear past the middle ear, but we'll get to that in a little bit. Now no air is able to pass between the outer ear and the middle ear through that tympanic membrane. It seals off the connection between the two. And that can cause problems. Think about any time you've gone up in an airplane or maybe you've driven up into the mountains and you start to feel this pressure build up in your ears. That's because you're changing elevation. If you're going up in elevation, you're going to an area where the air is thinner and so it's a lower pressure air. But the air in your middle ear stays the pressure that it already was. And so you're gonna have a higher pressure here than you do here, which is gonna be pushing on that tympanic membrane and stretching it, and that's gonna make things sound kind of muffled. It might be painful, just not a great experience. So we need a way to get air particles out of that middle ear, or if you're going down in elevation to get air particles back into that middle ear. For that, we have a structure called the Eustachian tube. That Eustachian tube is connected to the back of your throat, so air can pass, you know, from that middle ear to your throat where it can equalize that pressure. Now the Eustachian tube isn't just held open all the time, and so you might need to chew gum or swallow or do different things to allow that air to pass in and out. Also, if you've ever had an ear infection, you probably think about it as being mainly here, but it's really not. An ear infection tends to generally be in the middle ear where bacteria have made their way up through the Eustachian tube and now they're infecting this area right in there. Now what structures are actually contained inside the middle ear? Well, there's gonna be a set of three bones called the auditory ossicles. They're actually the tiniest bones in the human body, and we've got three of them. They're the malleus, the incus, and the stapes, also known as the hammer, anvil, and stirrup, but I'm gonna call them malleus, incus, and stapes for this video. Now the malleus, incus, and stapes look like they would be bones that kind of like bend compared to each other, like a synovial of a joint in your like elbow or something. They're actually not. They're gonna vibrate as one kind of rigid structure of the three bones connected to each other. You'll also notice that the malleus is connected to the tympanic membrane. So whenever the tympanic membrane vibrates, that's gonna cause these three bones to vibrate as well. And like I said, they vibrate as one structure. So if you imagine the malleus, incus, and stapes here, when they vibrate in one structure like this. Now they're provided an axis around which to kind of rock or vibrate through some ligaments that are holding them in place. So we've got these suspensory ligaments holding the auditory ossicles in place that are allowing them to vibrate or rotate around a particular axis so that the stapes can push into the next structure that we're about to talk about. Not only that, the auditory ossicles are going to function to amplify the vibrations. So those vibrations from the tympanic membrane, they're going to get amplified or sort of made louder or stronger by these series of three auditory ossicles. Without getting too much into the physics of it, you can think about like the vibrations are in this kind of big area and they're getting focused onto a much smaller section right there, which is going to make those vibrations stronger because we're going from a bigger to a smaller area. Now that stapes is going to push into a structure called the bony labyrinth, which has multiple parts, three parts in total. One part's called the vestibule, and the next part is called the cochlea. And the cochlea is going to be that kind of spiral or snail shell shaped part of this bony labyrinth. The job of the cochlea is going to be taking these vibrations from the stapes pushing into the bony labyrinth here. It's going to take those vibrations and convert those into action potentials or nerve signals that'll get sent to the brain that our brain can interpret and give meaning to. We'll dive way deeper into that in just a little bit. So that's the cochlea. And all of this bony labyrinth stuff is all part of the inner ear now. We move past the middle ear into the inner ear. Now, a couple of structures I want to add onto here. One is called the round window, and the other is called the oval window. The oval window is the section where the stapes is actually pushing into the bony labyrinth. And the round window is kind of a misleading name. It's not really an opening at all, but it's a part of the bony labyrinth that's a little bit softer and that can kind of push in and out, bulge out whenever the stapes is pushing into the oval window. So think about this, when the stapes pushes into the oval window, there has to be some other section, because this is all filled with fluid, there has to be some other part that can bulge out whenever the stapes pushes in. So that round window is just a soft spot in the bony labyrinth that can bulge in and out. Now also connected to the vestibule, we have the semicircular canals. We actually have three semicircular canals. Notice how they're oriented. So we have this one, and then we have another one kind of at a 90 degree angle to it. And then we have a third one kind of at a 90 degree angle to that. And so these are all oriented in the three different spatial dimensions, right? We exist in three-dimensional space. And so the purpose of the semicircular canals is to detect our balance. And so if we have a sudden shift in our head, like say that you're like, you're sitting here and you start to fall asleep and you do this, suddenly you're gonna be like jerked awake. What's happened there is as your head started to tilt, there's fluid and some other structures inside these semicircular canals that started to shift. Whenever that shift happened, a signal was sent from the semicircular canal through a nerve that we're gonna add on in just a minute to the brain, causing you to jerk back alert. And again, we have three of those, so we can detect that balance in three different dimensions. So semicircular canals are all about detecting our balance. Now to get these signals from the semicircular canals for balance or from the cochlea for the sounds that we hear, we have to have a nerve to conduct those signals. And so we've got the cochlear nerve right here connected to the cochlea, and we've got the vestibular nerve right here connected to the vestibule and the semicircular canals, and those are gonna converge together to form the vestibulocochlear nerve, which is cranial nerve number 8. Speaking of which, if you need to learn the 12 cranial nerves, I've got a video about that I just made pretty recently. That vestibulocochlear nerve is gonna transmit those signals to the brain, where our brain can then interpret them and give meaning to those sounds or the balance that we're detecting. So let's do a quick recap of this process. Our auricle is going to funnel sound through the auditory canal, which is going to cause our tympanic membrane to vibrate. The three auditory ossicles, malleus, incus, and stapes, are going to conduct those vibrations to the vestibule and the cochlea right here. They're also going to amplify those vibrations. That's going to push on some fluid in the cochlea and create some standing waves that are going to get detected by specialized hair cells, which we'll see in a minute. And those hair cells are going to send signals through the vestibulocochlear nerve to our brain, where our brain will interpret those signals as sound. We also have the semicircular canals to detect balance, and we have the Eustachian tube to balance the pressure between the middle ear and the outer ear. Now let's zoom in on the cochlea and take a look at what's really happening inside the cochlea whenever we're changing these signals from vibrations into action potentials or nerve signals. So I'm gonna take the cochlea here and I'm gonna kind of roll out the cochlea, extend it out right here, and do a cross section of it so we can see inside the cochlea. So let's name those sections. First we have the scala vestibuli. The scala vestibuli is gonna be filled with a fluid called paralymph. All paralymph means is, well, lymph means water, and para means outside. So this is the outside water inside the cochlea. This other section down at the bottom is the scala tympani, and this is all one continuous section, right? That's also filled with paralymph, right? It's the same fluid here. And so when those signals come in from the stapes, they'll travel down the scala vestibuli and then back to the round window through the scala tympani. The section in the middle is gonna be called the scala media. The scala media is also called the cochlear duct, and it's got a fluid in it called endolymph, which just means inside water. There's also something called the organ of Corti in here, which we're going to see, and some little hair cells that you can kind of see in there, but they're super small. We'll zoom in just a minute. Now, our cochlea needs to be able to detect different pitches. So like high sounds like this or low sounds like this. And how is our, sorry about that, that was alarming. So how do we detect the different pitches of sounds that we hear? When the stapes pushes in, it's going to send that signal down from here, and that signal can cause a standing wave in different regions of the cochlea. So high frequency sounds like ah, we're going to detect those at the proximal part or beginning part of the cochlea. And so maybe we've got a standing wave that's produced right here, and that's going to be a high frequency sound. Basically, the vibrations are going to be very fast compared to low frequency where the vibrations are a lot slower. And that'll produce that standing wave in the beginning or proximal part. And we'll detect that and interpret that by our brains as being a high pitch sound. We can detect middle kind of frequencies, medium frequencies, and those are going to be slower vibrations. We'll detect those kind of in the middle section of the cochlea. And if we have a low frequency sound like, oh, something like that, that's going to be detected at the distal or end of the cochlea. And notice when the standing waves are produced here, they're always going to be pushing down on the scala media. That's going to be important. They're pushing down on the scala media. That's going to cause these hair cells to kind of get bent over. It's going to send the action potential of the nerve signal to the brain from there. But let's take a moment right now and we're going to zoom in on a cross section of this so we can see what this organ of Corti and hair cells, what all the stuff that I've been referencing, what it actually looks like. So here would be a cross section of the cochlea. And so we've got the three parts here that we've already labeled. We've got the scala vestibuli, we have the scala tympani, and the scala media. Inside the scala media, we've got something called the tectorial membrane. This right here is the tectorial membrane. And notice it's got some cells that are underneath it right here. Let's add on to those. These are going to be the hair cells, these four hair cells, one, two, three outer, and one inner. These four hair cells are connected to neurons, which are going to form a nerve. That tectorial membrane, along with those hair cells, are form a structure that we call the organ of Corti. And this organ of Corti is really going to extend down the whole length of the cochlea. And if it gets stimulated here, again, those are high frequency sounds. And if it gets stimulated here, those are going to be low frequency sounds. But this is going to extend the whole length of the cochlea. Now, whenever those vibrations happen and we get a standing wave in the cochlea right here, that's going to push down on this tectorial membrane and stimulate these hair cells. Let's zoom in a little bit on a hair cell itself and that tectorial membrane. So we've got the tectorial membrane right here. We've got a hair cell shown right here. And then these little, the hairs, if you will, they're not really hairs like the hair on my beard, for example. They're just going to be cilia. We call them stereocilia that are sticking off the top of this hair cell. If you notice, there's going to be multiple stereocilia of different lengths, one of which is like up against the tectorial membrane. And then we've got a nerve that's connected to that hair cell. So whenever the standing wave happens and it pushes down on that tectorial membrane, that's going to cause the stereocilia to bend. When those stereocilia bend, that's going to depolarize this hair cell. And that's going to cause a signal to happen in the nerve that's connected to the hair cell. This is kind of wild, all the stuff that's involved in hearing that's happening in your head right now. So the tectorial membrane is going to bend down whenever there's a standing wave. It's going to push on those stereocilia, which is going to depolarize the hair cell and send the signal through the nerve, through the vestibulocochlear nerve, into our brain. And now let's take a look at the 3D model so we can see how these structures are actually kind of physically located three-dimensionally in our heads. So here's our 3D ear model from Axis Scientific from Anatomy Warehouse. Link in the description if you want to find out more about where I get my models from. Let's zoom in a little bit. We've got, of course, the auricle right here. It's going to be funneling sound down through the auditory canal, and that's going to come up against the tympanic membrane. So here's our tympanic membrane. Of course, it's going to vibrate, so I can grab this here. You know, whenever the sound comes in, it's going to vibrate like this. You'll see it's connected to the auditory ossicles, and so we've got those auditory ossicles here. We've got the malleus. Notice how it's got this kind of ridge that comes down. It kind of connects to the center of the tympanic membrane and rides up here. We've got some ligaments holding it into place. So there's the malleus, the incus, and then down in here we've got the stapes. And I can pull this out and we can kind of see a little bit what that looks like. There's the stapes right there. Of course, right here we've got the Eustachian tube, which is going to run down that way. So we can take out this bony labyrinth and we can see all three parts of it. We've got the semicircular canals, the vestibule, as well as the cochlea. And so those semicircular canals, you can see they're oriented at 90 degree angles with each other. So we can see that here any way that we turn it. We've got right here the vestibule. We've got the oval window that the stapes is going to be pushing into. So we can see the stapes kind of lines up and pushes into that. And then the cochlea right here. And then you can see here there's the vestibulocochlear nerve. It's got a section connected to the cochlea, a section connected to the vestibule, and it looks like there's one that runs up here close to those semicircular canals right there. Another cool thing that the 3D model kind of shows is that this whole bony labyrinth isn't just sort of freestanding in there. It's surrounded on all sides by the bone of the skull right here. And so even between the semicircular canals, it's surrounded by bone on all different sides, which is kind of cool. And there's a hole in the bone there where the stapes pushes through into that bony labyrinth. Of course, there's a few other structures on here that I didn't go over, like blood vessels and that sort of thing. And all of those you can see on the 3D model here. Pretty cool. So here's a blank diagram that you can use to practice with. Also, if you're just learning a lot of anatomy and physiology, I've got a whole set of A&P flashcards that cover all kinds of different structures from different systems, basically from almost all of my videos, including this video right here. So it's got the diagram on the front, as well as the names of all the structures on the back. There's a link in my description for the store where you can buy those flashcards. Anyway, if you haven't already, pause the video, see if you can name the structures on the diagram here. All right, and here are those structures back, so you can check and see how you did. Hey, special thanks to all my supporters on Patreon, as well as my YouTube channel members. I appreciate the support, the monthly support from you all. If you're interested in joining this group of awesome people right here, there's a link in the description for that, or you can find on YouTube, you can find a place there to join as a channel member. Members on both of those platforms get access to all of the diagrams that I use, like in higher resolution, blank and completed diagrams. So you can just download all of those, as well as a few other kind of perks that go along with those. I also have some resources to help you learn anatomy and physiology that I've got for sale. One is those A&P study cards that you can use digitally or you can print them. I've got comprehensive guides for a bunch of different A&P systems, and we're making more of those. And I've got a free A&P survival guide that'll give you the best strategies for learning anatomy and physiology. So if you want to maximize your time and save time as you're learning all of this stuff, check out my free survival guide as well. Hey, thanks for watching the video. Thanks for learning about the ear. Here's another video of mine if you want to keep learning some anatomy and physiology. And again, thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye-bye.